Greetings, brothers and sisters. The Methodist Church St. Lucia Circuit welcomes you to our virtual worship of Thanksgiving for today, Sunday, October 3rd, 2021. We may be physically isolated, but not separated. We are united as a body of Christ. We are the church, and so it is our joy to have you worshiping with us. Today, we are grateful for the opportunity to partake in the sacrament of Holy Communion. As a church family, we celebrate with each other and we grieve with each other. Congratulations to all those celebrating a birthday, wedding anniversary, or any other special occasion. May God's glory shine bright in your lives. We express our heartfelt sympathy to the family of Margaret Ruder Mitchell of the Groseillers congregation. May God's comfort ignite peace at this time. We remember in our prayers our nation and its people, those mourning the loss of loved ones, as well as those of our fellowship who are sick, housebound, or heavy laden. The circuit is organizing in-gathering midday services conducted by Reverend Smith on Wednesday, October 6th and 13th from 12 to 1 p.m. within the confinements of the COVID-19 protocols. Kindly submit your names to the circuit office if you plan to attend, as we cannot exceed 50 persons. Circuit Bible study continues weekly, this and every Wednesday at 7 p.m. via Zoom. We encourage you to join us as we seek to deepen our spirituality. We continue to encourage your generous support to the work of God in this circuit. Your tithes, offerings, and donation can be deposited to the Republic Bank St. Lucia, account number 950100059919, or visit the church office Monday to Friday from 9 to 3 p.m. We thank you for your faithful giving. A heartfelt thank you to those who continue to make our worship experience possible. We thank you for your time and talent, and we pray that God continues to bless you as He uses us for the advancement of His kingdom here on earth. And I leave with us the quote for this week: be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Romans chapter 12, verse 12.
Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our God and Maker. Welcome to another act of worship and thanksgiving service as we celebrate God. I invite all of you to praise God. Let us turn to our order of service and respond appropriately. Worship God in the beauty of holiness. Let all the peoples praise you. Let all the peoples praise you. God, our God, has blessed us. May God continue to bless us. Let all the ends of the earth revere Him. We continue as we sing hymn 518. This is my Father's world.
To my listening ear.
is my Father's world. Let us go to God in prayer. Our prayer of adoration, thanksgiving, and confession. Adorable God, the creator of everything, we come before you, O God, knowing that you have created us for your purpose. You have created everything else, O God, for us, O God, to enjoy, because you are God. And because you are God, O Lord, we come before you, bowing our hearts in recognition that you alone is God and will always be God. And so we thank you for being our Father. We adore you, O God, for who you are, and for all that you have done, for all that you, dear God, have done, whether seen or unseen. We just want to say how grateful we are. Loving God, this morning, we give you all the praise and all the thanks because you are God. You, dear God, who have created us in your image and likeness and told us, dear God, that we are just like you. We call to mind, dear Father, the many times when we have erred and strayed away from you because of our disobedience of heart. Our behavior, dear God, did not pattern what your purpose for our life should be. And so we ask for your forgiveness. We ask, O God, that you cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Create in us a heart only to praise and to worship you. And so we bow in reverence, O God, trusting not in our own strength, but depending upon you to wash us, mold us, and make us to praise you. Father God, forgive us for the times when we have hurt each other, in thought, in word, or in deed. Forgive us for the many times, O God, when we have erred and caused someone to stumble. May you, dear God, give us a heart to love and to appreciate humankind and everything else. We thank you, O God, for life. We thank you for this opportunity that we can worship you in spirit and in truth. We thank you for this opportunity, O God, that we can give thanks as we prepare to celebrate this Thanksgiving week. Most importantly, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, who shed his blood at Calvary. We thank you, O God, that he promises that he will never leave us nor forsake us. And so we thank you for that confidence that we can trust him and believe in him. We thank you for friends, for loved ones. We thank you, O God, for the spaces in which we can come together to worship only you. And so this morning, as we say thank you, God, for being God and God alone, give us a heart to praise you. Give us a heart of fellowship with each other. And give us a heart, O God, to love each other. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We continue as we sing the hymn 247, Worship and Thanks and Blessing.
Jesus, 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 Jes
Let us prayerfully pray the collect for today. Almighty and everlasting God, increase in us your gift of faith that forsaking what lies behind and reaching out to that which is before, we may run the way of your commandments and win the crown of everlasting joy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. The epistle reading is taken from Hebrews chapter 1, reading from verses 1 to 4, and chapter 2, verses 5 to 11.
Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the world. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being, and he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. Having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Now God did not subject the coming world about which we are speaking to angels, but someone has testified somewhere, "What are human beings that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them a little while longer than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now, in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them. But we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the sufferings of death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. It is fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us continue as we stand for the reading of the gospel found in Mark chapter 10, verses 2 to 16. Glory to you, O God. Some Pharisees came, and to test him, they asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." Then in the house of the disciples, asked him again about the matter. He said to them, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another man, she commits adultery. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is in such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. And he took them up in his arms, laid his hand on them, and blessed them. Brothers and sisters, the gospel of Christ. Kindly sit. Our hymn of preparation, hymn number 509, Come, Ye Thankful People, Come. People come, as we give God thanks in this time, we want to remember that our God is a great big God, and there is nothing that is impossible that He can't do. Is time running out on Christians? in the wake of the world's crisis? Have you let down your guard in midst of trusting for salvation? Has the crisis forced you to give up on God? No matter what, the situation, no matter how much you have gone through, I am here to encourage you not to give up. I am here to tell you to persevere in the face of your struggles. No matter what form it takes, just trust God, the creator of all things, the God who has and will not fail you. Only depend on his grace to sustain you. And through the testing times, you do the right thing, even when it hurts. Let the Spirit of God strengthen you to stand up, to hold the faith through suffering and persecution. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you that you still love us in and out of season. We thank you, O God, that you still look after us even when we want to turn our backs. We thank you, God, that you continue to seek your children wherever they are. And so this morning, we know, dear God, that you are a never-failing God. And no matter what, give us the strength to hold on. Now may the words of my mouth, the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. The letter of Hebrews was written to the Hebrew Christians who may have been considering to return to Judaism. They might have had weak or immature faith or lack of understanding to the biblical truth. They might have been facing or undergoing intense persecution, socially and physically, from Jews and Romans. Christ had not yet returned to establish his kingdom, and they were looking to be reassured. Jesus is the Messiah. God was in conversation since the creation and continues to converse with us today. God has made his factual statement throughout the Bible that his Son, in whom is he, is well pleasing, will return to save the world. You see, everything and everyone is second match when it comes to Christ. Christ is superior to all, and therefore Christians who worship and believe in Jesus, who has faith and trust God, their faith in Christ enables them to face trials and tribulation. Therefore, Christianity supersedes all other religion and never can be surpassed. Where can anyone find anything better? Hence, living in and for Christ is having the best there in life. The Jews who had become Christians in the first century were tempted to fall back into Judaism because of uncertainty. The security and customs and persecution today believers are also tempted to fall back due to the loss of jobs, threats of vaccination, and a broken and lawless society and in the world. COVID-19 pandemic threatens us and our livelihood, even our faith with the closed doors from Sunday to Sunday. But amid the struggles, don't lose focus. You see, the Jewish Christians were discouraged and needed some encouragement. I can hear you saying, your heart is broken. I can hear you through your pain in this difficult times of life. I can hear you saying, I am out of work. The bills are to be paid. My kids are hungry. But be encouraged, brothers and sisters, listening friends. Help is on its way. I encourage you to continue to do the things with the right attitude, just like Jesus did in his day. Our reading in Hebrews would show us that Christ is superior in all things, that God has spoken, Jesus is fully God and fully man, that Jesus is the reflection of God. Hebrews reminds us today that Jesus is better than everything else, that Jesus is the answer and has all the answer to the pandemic situation and all that goes on in our world, that Jesus is the way the world should follow, and no matter what, Jesus has the final say. When God speaks, no one do the opposite, or else you face the consequence. Verse 1 says, long ago, God spoke in many different ways, through prophets, dreams, our forefathers, even face to face. He does the same today. God's speaking to man is to enlighten them, for he is the light of the world. Our greatest need at this time with the global crisis is to hear from God, is for us to trust God, even though it may not be doing good to anyone. Let us remember that even in the darkest moment, we need to trust God. Without God's voice, we are lost in sin and traumatized by persecution. We would be lost wondering what life is all about. What's our purpose? We would not know who we are, why we are here, or what we are here for. But God continues not to be silent. He continues to speak. God has chosen us, even before the world existed, to be a part of him. We are his people, and he longs for us. He loves us despite everything else seems to prove otherwise. God chose his son to speak to us today. Are we listening? Are we hearing his voice? Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. In Jesus, the world receive her King as we sing our Christmas hymn, the one she groans for throughout the ages. But God said, It's finally in person that Jesus is the Savior of the world. The world ever needs Jesus. It is now. If you are not already a born-again Christian, today you can trust Jesus as your Savior. He is your all in all. He is all you and I need. Secondly, Jesus is fully God. God's message is that Jesus is not merely from God. Jesus is God when Jesus was born. God in all wisdom and power added humanity without losing divinity. Verse 2b says, through whom also he created the world. The creation story reminds us God created everything, and all was good. But mankind has messed up that relationship. Sin has marred the clean state of togetherness with Jesus. According to Romans 8, verse 8 to 10, reminds us that the Spirit of God frees us from sin. You will begin to believe when you are free from sin that Jesus Christ is God's Son. You'll begin to act as Christ directs. You will find help in your daily trials and struggles. You will begin to be empowered to serve God and to do His will and become a part of God's plan to build up His church here on earth. Is there someone else who could create life where life has not existed? I encourage you, try Jesus, for He is the life of our lives. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. The same way God made us alive in the beginning through His Son. This God changes not, and He continues to change not, but changes our situation, and He can change the pandemic situation. Only when we persevere in and through Him. To persevere is to continue in a course of action. Even in the midst of difficulty or with little or no prospect of success. The letter written to the Jewish Christians, as well as the Gentile Christians who had come to Christ, was to show them that they are to live in faith and hope. The author said, many have suffered persecution, rejection, throughout history, such as stolen property, beatings, imprisonment, and much more. These have been the faith of countless Christians. It's hard to imagine the temptation that persecution brings. However, Christians who live in peace and safety often compromise their faith even without threats. Just imagine how tempting it would be to protect yourself, to protect your spouse, to protect your children, to protect your closest friends from serious harm. In light of the pandemic globally, and as a nation, how could we possibly encourage fellow believers? Hebrews 12, 3 to 4 says, to be willing to bear the reproach of Christ is to face exclusion from society, even the church. Therefore, true Christians must hold their faith. Don't throw away that great salvation which the blood of Christ has offered you and me. Jesus came on earth to offer in exchange for our souls. As verse 3a reads, he is the reflection of God's glory and the imprint of God's very being. When Jesus came to earth, he came with all his glory. Thirdly, Jesus is fully man. We should persevere, trusting God to reward and renew. Verse 2a says, whom he appointed heirs of all things. Brothers and sisters, God is God. God is who he is. Therefore, when you are going through persecution of any sort, you need encouragement to keep going and hope that you are going to make it through. John 15 reminds us that God's word is a voice of authority, which tells us persecution may be your salvation experience. Remember, the world hated Jesus. He was persecuted. He was rejected. He was brutally hung on the cross. Therefore, for us Christians, we would be persecuted also. But Jesus said, I will send you the advocate, the superior Son of God, who would help us in this time not to lose faith and hope, but to press on to do the right things in spite of all mistreatment that you and I may receive. Be assured, brothers and sisters, what you are experiencing today is truly part of God's grace, for his grace is sufficient to keep us. Remember, God spoke and continues to speak today. He is superior, and all we need for today, he is fully God and fully man. We need God more than ever. Whatever you are going through, persevere in the midst of suffering. Jesus is the answer. Brothers and sisters, remember in your suffering to give God thanks, for this may be the way of your salvation. As we celebrate Thanksgiving, let us give God thanks for spared life. Let us give God thanks for our family. Let us give God thanks for our friends. Let us give God thanks for Jesus has come in among us. Jesus is in the midst of our persecution, and therefore, he will strengthen us to face whatever comes our way. God's time is our time. Let us trust him. Persevere in your suffering. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. At this time, we are going to prepare ourselves for the sacrament of Holy Communion. I invite Reverend Smith for us to participate in the act of communion. Kindly turn to number 76 in your prayer book. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and fitting so to do. It is a good and pleasant thing, joyful and salutary always and everywhere, to give you thanks and praise. Lord God, ever living, ever blessed, almighty, all loving, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord, you created all things and made us in your image, and when we had fallen into sin, you gave him to be our Savior. He shared our human nature and lived a fully human life. He suffered rejection and condemnation and died on the cross. You raised him up from the dead, and you exalted him to the glory of your right hand, where he reigns forever as priest and king and makes intercession for us. In witness of his glory and honor, you poured out the Holy Spirit, building up many people into one body, making us living members of your holy church, and enabling us to stand before you, to sing your praises and celebrate your mighty acts. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we join in the hymn of everlasting praise.
Blessed are you, Lord God, King of the universe, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread into his holy hands, and looking up to heaven, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me."
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore, Father, in obedience to his command, we do this in remembrance of him, praying that you will accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we who receive your gifts of bread and wine may share in the body and blood of Christ and become united with him. And as we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice, we pray that you will bring us with your whole creation to your heavenly kingdom. And this we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
To whom with you, O Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory from all who dwell on earth and in heaven, throughout the ages of ages. Amen.
The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ.
Amen.
The cup of blessing which we bless is a sharing in the blood of Christ.
Amen. Though we are many, we are one body, because we share of the one loaf and partake of the same drink.
A time of silence. Bowing our hearts before God, who has made space for us, let us make space for God as he has sacrificially gave his Son, his body and his blood for you and for me. Lord, we come to your table, trusting in your mercy and not in any goodness of our own. We are not worthy to gather up the crumbs under your table, but it is your nature always to have mercy, and on that we depend. So feed us with the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and he in us. Amen. You who are truly and sincerely repentant of your sins, are in love and charity with your neighbors, and have resolved to lead a new life following the commandments of God by the power of the Spirit, walking in his holy ways, draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, his blood which was shed for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The table of the Lord is prepared. All are welcome. Christ, take it in remembrance of Christ. Blood of Christ, take, drink in remembrance of Christ.
Let us pray. The blood of Christ, which was broken for your people here on earth, O God, we thank you whenever we eat that you have shed your blood for our sins. And so as we boldly come before your throne of grace, no matter what, O God, we will continue to trust you because we know that you are a healing God. And so as we take of your body and your blood, we thank you for wholeness. In Jesus' name we pray. Together, we thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet prepared for all mankind. Amen. Our prayers of intercession, our children's story, and then our prayers of intercession.
Good morning, brothers and sisters, and I do hope that you have invited the young ones to come and join you. My story this morning is about a young man, or a man, his name was Clifford. And Clifford was at school, and everybody knew that Clifford was the brightest boy in the school. When you saw his annual report, everything, English first, French first. In those days, we did Latin at school too. Clifford first, mathematics first, science first, attendance first class, everything. Clifford was known for being first in everything. And one day, he announced that his goal in life was to be, and he expected everyone to accept it, was expect excellence. Expect excellence. And he lived by that code. That was his motto in life, and that is how he lived his life. When he was in senior school, he announced that he was going to break the record for the 400 meters. Now, this was a difficult race because it wasn't a sprint and it wasn't a long distance race. It was a middle distance race. Everybody in the school was amused because Clifford was known to be a brilliant student of his studies. But he was no athlete, as far as they knew. But Clifford persisted that he was going to break the record for the senior 400 meters. He barely qualified. He barely qualified for the finals on sports day. On sports day, as the race began, for the first 100 yards, everybody settled down to do what they could do. Clifford jumped to the front, and Clifford started to run and soon opened a gap of about 5 meters on the rest of the field. But nobody took him seriously. They all said he would burn out in a short time. 200 meters to go. Clifford was still doing very well. 100 meters to go, time to get serious. The leading athletes took turns to try and catch Clifford. But Clifford kept on going. And eventually, he hit the tape, and he won by a clear 3 meters. And he had broken the record. When he was asked afterwards, Clifford, how did you do that? He said, as in everything in my life, I prepared for it. I prepared for it. I trained myself to win that race. He remained at school for another 3 years, but he never took part in any more sports. I learned later on that he had gone off overseas, and he was highly qualified and working with some international organization. What I'm trying to say to you today, children, is that when you take up a challenge, like Clifford, he always said, expect excellence, and he never fooled around. He always tried his very best to do the very best. As I said earlier, one of his mottos was expect excellence, and he always boasted there's only one way to do it, and that's the right way. And that is how he lived himself. So, children, today I want to set before you the example of Clifford, who set himself a goal which everybody thought would be impossible. And he achieved it because he lived by his motto, expect excellence. And there is only one way to do it. and that's the right way. Hold on to those two little sayings and try to live your life accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Bert Smith. Prepare for excellence, everyone. At this time, we are going to invite Brother Marshall to do our prayers of intercession.
Let us go to God in prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Remember, O Lord, your whole church throughout the world, and continually enrich it with the gifts of the Holy Spirit, that in faith and unity we may constantly be renewed by the Holy Spirit for witness and service. Look with compassion upon the peoples of the world and give wisdom and grace to their leaders, that they may promote justice, freedom, and peace for all. Remember also in your mercy our own country of St. Lucia and all who are in positions of authority and influence, that they may serve with wisdom, honesty, and compassion. Remember, O Lord, in your mercy, the president of our conference, the chairman of our district, our ministers, preachers, visitors, teachers, leaders, counselors, and officers, and all others who bear responsibility among us, that they may continually be renewed in faith and have in them the mind that is in Christ Jesus. Remember, O Lord, the children and young people of this congregation, and especially those who at this time may be receiving instructions in preparation for confirmation, that by grace we may grow in wisdom and in the knowledge and love of God. Give wisdom and grace to all teachers and students in our institutions of learning, that among them true knowledge may increase and our future as a people may be safeguarded. Remember, O Lord, in your mercy, all those of our society who are unemployed, all who are overworked, those whose work is not appreciated, those who do not like the work they do, or who work under undue strain and temptation, that they may receive the gift of faith to cope with the present, and the present of hope to strive for a better future. Send your blessings, O Lord, upon our families, and fill our homes with love and peace, that we may have in this present life a foretaste of the life to come. Remember also, in your mercy, those of our fellowship who are in trouble, anxiety, sickness, grief, or any kind of need. Relieve the oppressed, support the neglected, and recall to yourself those who have erred and strayed from your ways. And so increase in us the spirit of compassion and care, that we may be ministers in your name for their recovery and relief. O God, in whom we are one family in earth and heaven, we now call to mind those who have died, giving thanks also for those who have revealed to us your grace in Christ Jesus. Help us to follow the examples of our saints in light and bring us with them into the fullness of your eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We will now recite the Our Father together, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thine will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, as we bring our worship to a close, we sing hymn 508, Abide With Me. At this time, I just want to reflect upon the life of our dear sister Margaret, and I join with the Grosse Lake congregation as they remember her during this time of thanksgiving. Abide with me.
Thank you.
the benediction. Now the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, with the blood of eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good thing to do his will, working in us that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and mind in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Have a blessed month of October.